Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Positively Responding to Spirit Influence, and it is part of Spirit Relationship Series. It was presented in Murgon, Queensland, Australia on the 6th of October, 2012. This is Session 1, Part 1.
Well,
okay. So,
we would like to firstly, we should have done this at the start, but welcome all of you along for the first time in 4 or 5 months that we've seen you. Thanks for coming along today. Have you found your life quite difficult over the last 4 or 5 months? Or quite...
Easy.
Easy. Challenging? Interesting? Challenging? Yeah. I feel one of the main reasons why we get quite heavily challenged is because of this topic we would like to discuss today. So the topic, if we just outline the topic. So it's part of the Spirit Relationship series of talks. And the topic is positively, what did we say the next word was?
Responding.
Responding, that's right. To spirit influence. To introduce the topic, we'd like to outline with you some of the things that we noticed that happen quite regularly, and particularly lately in our interactions with different people. And we were talking to some people that I've known for 5 years overseas have emailed me very recently and said to me things like, I have never trusted you the entire time that I've known you, for example, right? And I go, that's very interesting. And then they outline a whole series generally, or sometimes not, you know, sometimes it's just a blanket statement like that, of reasons why they can't trust me, none of which are actually logical or that have actually happened. And I find this quite interesting because it tells me that they're under quite a lot of heavy influence. I've actually had people scream at me that they don't trust me, like literally scream at me that they don't trust me. Obviously in a, you know, overcloaked by a spirit at the time. So that's been very, very interesting. Now, I'm not saying you have to trust me. What I'm saying is it's pretty unusual to know somebody for 5 years and come along to many of the sessions they give for free without actually developing some kind of trust, at least, right? And then for do that for 5 years and then still not be able to trust, there's obviously something going on, right? There's obviously something else happening. We also find lately when we're invited to go around to people's homes, many times we're invited to go out to dinner to somebody's house or something like that, what we find is before we go to the place, the people get attacked by spirit so much, but by the time we arrive, they are so frightened of seeing us that sometimes we feel like we should probably just turn around and go back home because of the fear that's being projected. Recently, we went and visited somebody's house where this happened, and this is something that's regularly occurring now with us. So we're invited to go somewhere. Somebody feels like they would like to have us around or whatever. We go there, and before we arrive, the person becomes so spirit influenced that by the time we arrive, they're literally shaking with fear of us. Like, as if you have anything to fear from us, right? And a lot of times this is very, very heavy spirit projections of rage at any single person who has anything to do with us. That's really what is actually happening, but most people don't recognize it as such, and so they just feel like really bad now that they've invited us to go to their place. So this is something that's also happening very regularly. What we're also finding is that in many of our presentations that we do now, there are large groups of people who originally say they want to come, and then when we actually do a presentation in a location, most of them do not come. So they've invited us to go to a location, and we go to the location and we start, you know, doing something with the people in the location, but a lot of people have not bothered coming, and we can feel how much of that is spirit influence, like to not interact. Like I said, when we were in Brazil, there was a lot of spirit influence there to influence people to not even arrive or have that first interaction. And it was so interesting how much that occurred that in the end we almost just go, oh, okay, there's probably only going to be three people here this time, you know, even though there were 70 or 80 or 100 people who had indicated that they wanted to come. And as it turned out, we finished up changing venues at the last minute and all sorts because we just knew that, you know, the venues were just far too large for what would be the audience. Again, it's a lot to do with spirit influence, people being influenced. And many of you also be noticing that sometimes when you get under pressure, you almost revert to old behaviours. Have you noticed that? So some of you were away, we've heard from some saying, you know, oh yeah, I got drunk a few times while you're away, you know, and this kind of thing happened while you're away, and that kind of thing happened while you're away, because there are certain spirit influences upon you that occur, and then it causes you to go into a state that you sort of forget who you are or the difference between yourself and what influence you're receiving. And a lot of people are not aware of how much they are being influenced by spirits. Now, I'm not saying all of this to frighten any of you, because I don't believe there's anything to be frightened about. Firstly, we must recognize that spirits are just normal people. Many of us forget that in our interactions with them. They are just normal people who have lived on earth, who have now passed. That's all they are. So they have very similar feelings to what you have about all sorts of stimuli, and they respond in a very similar way to what you respond. They are just normal people. So the average person you meet down the street is no different to the average spirit you are going to meet.
Right? Who agrees with that?
Do many of you are understanding this, yes? Yes. This is very important that you keep this in mind. Because these people who are now without a physical body can only influence you in the same way that any person on earth can only influence you. There's only one difference. They can influence you without you feeling or seeing their presence. That's the only difference. Everyone understands that? They can only influence you most of the time because you do not see them with you. And because you do not see them or feel them or even hear them, they are dropping thoughts into your mind, they are causing you to have certain interactions in your day-to-day life without you being aware of how much influence is actually happening. Does that make sense? So what we need to do is we need to start understanding better how to combat these kind of influences. How many years have you been waiting for such a discussion? Yeah. So what Mary has got organised is, it's sort of, the way this is going to proceed is sort of, Mary's got some subjects and topics that she would like me to cover during this discussion, and she will probably be involved in the discovery of them as well. We're happy for your questions to be involved in this presentation, so please feel free to ask questions as you go, but please make sure the questions are not taking us off on a different subject, but rather as spot on the subject that we're discussing, if we can.
Okay, so as you have introduced, this idea of spirit influence is something that lots of you are quite familiar with now already, but there were two main things that you said that you would really like to emphasize with people of common pitfalls that people fall into when they hear the teachings of divine truth, they hear about everything. The first one was that people often forget that the divine love path is actually about developing a relationship with God. So who can relate to that, like kind of losing sight of that thing and going, oh, it's emotions, oh, it's spirits, oh, it's this, oh, I've got to, you know, stay the truth, to be like, whoa, hang on, isn't this about God? And we can end up down like a side track. Yeah.
Many of us have forgotten that it's about your relationship with God. It's not about you focusing on your emotions at all. You need to be connected emotionally in order to connect with God. But it's not about focusing on your emotions at all. It's not even about focusing on your desires, although it's great if you have a desire and you follow that with some passion, particularly if your primary desire is to have a relationship with God, right? But there are issues to do with becoming more loving, I agree. But it's not about focusing on becoming more loving. In other words, trying hard to be more loving, right? The reality is if you focus on your relationship with God, you will automatically become more loving through that relationship, through that particular relationship that gets established, right? On the YouTube over the next few weeks, we'll be adding an interview that was done with Dane. Do you want to put your hand up, Dane? So that's Dane there. It was a lovely interview, by the way. I just really enjoyed
very
watching.
Very inspiring, Dane.
Very inspiring interview. And Dane was asked many things about his personal life and so forth, and he was very, very open and honest about all of his life. But one of the primary things that he realised and it comes through in the interview is this: relationship with God. Focus on a relationship with God. When you focus on a relationship with God, all other things sort themselves out, actually. You actually have more drive and desire in your life. You actually become more joyful, not negative, when you focus on this particular relationship. Many of us get influenced into focusing on everything else but our relationship with God. And that's why many of us do finish up feeling sad at times or feel like we're being overwhelmed by emotion at times and so forth. The reality is if you focus on that relationship, everything will automatically come to you that you need in order to grow. And it's very important to understand.
And when you consider a bunch of spirits with the awesome power and love of God, you know who's going to win that little battle, don't you? A lot of times we're focusing on our relationships with spirits or allowing our relationships with spirits to dominate our life, forgetting about God, when really if we realigned our focus to this relationship with God, a lot of the perceived power we give to all these spirits would disappear. We would realise, wow, actually, when I'm really connecting with God, when I'm focusing on God, these guys can't even have an impact on me.
Mm. Yeah. They only have an impact when you walk away, really, from God. Remember the very first emotional injury that ever occurred on this planet? It was walking away from the Creator, right? So the reality is every time we walk away from the Creator, we are just involved in that emotional injury again. And we need to focus on dealing with that emotional injury, because without this relationship, without the one with God, very little else can really occur in a loving way. You see, natural love fails under certain circumstances. Have you noticed that? People who are loving, who are normally loving when everything's going fine for them, turn into monsters sometimes when everything's not going fine. A person who has God's love in them doesn't change even if things are not going fine. They are still loving. That's a sign. You can't manufacture that place. You're not going to be able to try to do that. It will only come by you receiving divine love, and that divine love will transform your ability to be able to live in situations that are harsh at times and still be loving. That's the beauty of it. So we don't have to try to be more loving. We need to have a stronger connection with God and receive more of that love from God. And as we do that, it will transform our ability to love. Natural love by itself, the love that normally comes out of your heart towards another person, can easily be manipulated by any addiction that you have. That's the reality. So if you have an addiction of one kind, let's say it's a sexual addiction or an emotional addiction of one kind, or a physical addiction to some kind of, you know, like alcohol, drugs, or some kind of substance, food even, like whatever the addictions are, you can be manipulated through those if you're only reflecting on your own love. But once you have this relationship with God, there becomes a quality in that relationship called integrity that builds inside of you. And once integrity builds inside of you, you are unable to be hateful or hurtful or angry towards another person while that integrity remains within you. That's the beauty. That's partly how it transforms you. It gives you this ability to live in an environment that often is harsh, but still be loving yourself without trying. Without trying. And if we have to try, that is just an indication that we've yet to receive divine love enough to no longer need to try. That's all it's an indication of. And the second thing?
Second thing, which kind of contradicts my point, people often forget what they are up against in terms of opposition.
Yes, so relationship with God is our primary motivation for being here, okay? That's my personal opinion anyway. Now, hopefully your primary motivation for listening in the audience is for the same thing. The development of this relationship with God. Now, many times we have selfish motivations, don't we? That we have, like, oh, I want to become a better person, or I want to have a happier life, or my law of attraction is very, very, we call it my law of attraction, interestingly enough, but we say, I'm attracting harsh things at the moment. I'd like to attract something better. You know, so these are all what I would classify as selfish motivations. You see, we have to give up the selfish motivations and just focus on relationship with God, which is not a selfish motivation, actually. And we can talk about why maybe in another talk. But our list of selfish motivations are all driven by a group of emotions that we must call addictions. Right? We have these motivations because there are certain things that we want that we haven't been getting in our life, or that we need more of in our life, and we focus on having that drive us. They are addictions. Interestingly enough, the very people who do not want us to have a relationship with God are also very interested in you maintaining your addiction. This applies not just to people who are in the spirit world, but every single person who is currently in our life usually has some kind of addiction with us. Right? Now, you will know the ones who don't, because when you don't give them what they seem to want, they're still happy with you. Right? How many times are people still happy with you when you no longer give them what they want? Can you see how rare that is, actually? So the majority of people are actually having an addictive relationship with us without even knowing. Now, this also applies to the people who we cannot see, which are people who have passed from this life into what we call the spirit life, but are still who are primarily earthbound. They still live around the earth here. Now, they desire to prevent us from having a relationship with God, because they can see that if you develop a relationship with God, they will get less of their addictions met. Right? So they do not want you to sincerely develop a relationship with God. Now, this was mentioned in the Paget messages. The very prayer that was given to James Paget mentions this problem. So perhaps if we can quote that part of the prayer.
So towards the end of the prayer, there's the passage. Keep us in the shadow of your love every hour and moment of our lives, and help us to overcome all the temptations of the flesh and the influence of the powers of the evil ones who so constantly surround us and endeavour to turn our thoughts away from you to the pleasures and allurements of this world.
Can you see the relationship? All of these things that I'm calling addictions, let's call them the pleasures and allurements of this world. Yeah. Can you see? And they sometimes tempt us. Do they not? Yeah. Now, these are spirits who and people around us on you know who are on earth would like us to be involved in these particular things. Sometimes they can see within us very easily that we would like to be involved in those particular things. It's much more easily seen by a spirit than it is perhaps another person. Natalie?
AJ, I'm just, as you're talking, I'm feeling about how people that we can see, our friends, our family, you can feel when a person influences you. You can tell from their body language, you can see from the way their facial expressions are, their tone of voice changes. And in times in my life, I've found I've been easily influenced by my friends because I agree with a lot of the things that they're saying to me.
Exactly.
Now,
You also have, many people, I'm saying, not just yourself, have also this attitude of, if I disagree with my friends, then I'm going to lose my friends, and I'm very invested in maintaining my friends, so that means I have to agree with them. And so you have this fear of being different, which is present. Yep.
So then what I still struggle with is discerning I still try to view them as spirit friends. Even though they're not always friendly.
They don't feel very friendly sometimes, yes.
But sometimes their thoughts are so aligned with the things that I agree with that are in error, I can't tell what's them and what's me.
Exactly. And we will discuss how to look at that during this discussion.
Okay.
Because this is a primary problem that many of us have. Our thoughts are so in line. The reason why they're so in line is these people are people who come from the earth. They are people who have lived a life the same as we have. They often had exactly the same desires as what we currently have. They often had exactly the same kind of experiences. They missed out on exactly the same things and they liked exactly the same things. And of course, it's so easy for them to just drop a little thought here, drop a little thought there, because we are so in line with them.
Like they're the ultimate debate team. Of justification and reasoning that, those thoughts sometimes, and you go, oh,
yeah, I sort of feel though that if they were debating, then that would indicate there is some disalignment within ourselves. Most of the time, we are actually perfectly in harmony with them and we don't need much convincing at all, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll talk about that. The other thing that we want to talk about with this as well is this constant feeling that we sometimes have that how do I tell the difference between my thoughts, their thoughts, my feelings, their feelings, and so forth. And many of you worry about that. And it's quite easy, actually, to tell the difference many times. But we often do not accept that we actually have a sympathy for their feelings, that we actually have a sympathy for their thoughts, that we actually would prefer to have their thought than the one that's being suggested that love is. Many times that's the case, and we need to have a look at that. And we're partly what we'll discuss, we'll address some of that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Graham.
Thanks, Graham.
Could you just clarify earthbound spirits for me?
Sure. Let's again mention that, because it's important to understand what happens with many of the spirits. So here's our earth. There's what, 7 billion people? 7.2, I think, something like that at the moment, billion people on this planet. Right? These are people who have physical bodies. And when a person passes or dies, many of the persons do not know where to go, do not know what to do, do not know what life they want, or if they do, many of them feel quite addicted to what they had on the earth. So you imagine if you smoker on the earth, you know, you pass, and there's no cigarette smoke in the spirit world, so what would you want to do? Come back to the earth and try to connect with somebody who smokes. You know, it's the same with the drinker, the same with many other emotional addictions that we have. So many people pass into the spirit world from this earth. They now no longer have a physical body, but they do not want to remain in the spirit world in the location that they themselves have prepared for themselves through their actions for in the spirit world. So what they do is they come back to earth and maintain connections with people on earth. Those spirits become bound to the earth in that the majority of the time they are not in the spirit world in the sense of like in the location that would normally be their home, but rather they have made their home on the earth somewhere. Many times in your own house, actually. Or other places, you know, that they've lived in their life, favourite places that they have. There are around 22 billion of those, of spirits who are bound to the earth in this way. Three persons for every one of us, on the average. We gave a seminar in England, and there was at least 100 people, spirit people, for every person who was present. Very oppressive environment. That was our first talk we gave in England this year. And very noticeable. One of the persons knew that they had 1,000 persons with them while they were present at the talk. Many of them communicate with these spirits regularly. So these spirits are bound to the earth in that they, through their addictions that they still want to have met, feel that the earth is the only place where their addictions can be met. In addition, they often do not have a clear understanding about the spirit world. So they do not understand that there's a home for them in the spirit world. It might not be a home that they necessarily like, and that's why they don't want to necessarily understand that. But also there are many belief systems that we imbibe here on earth that cause us to not even be open to the fact that we've even passed. And so many of these spirits have even no idea that they're not physical. And I've spoken to many of them who say, why doesn't the person listen to me? They should be listening to me. And you find out the person they're referring to is still alive on earth, and yet they've died. And so, you know, of course, they don't even understand why somebody who they used to interact with on earth no longer talks to them. So these are very many spirits who are in that position. Like I said, 3 spirits on the average for every single person alive. Yeah. If we go just next to you, Peter, over there. Thanks. And who had their hand here? Yes.
Hello. Do they have a choice to go back to the spirit world?
Yes.
As if they desire to go to the spirit world, they can have. They can leave if they want to.
They can go back and forward only to the place where their soul allows them to.
Yeah.
So for many of them, that is worse than the earth in terms of the location. And so they don't want to go there, of course.
Okay, thanks. Yep.
But it's very much based on the soul desire, Christy. So it's not an intellectual thought, oh, I should go somewhere else. It's like when we have an addiction to something that is so strong that our intellect might protest, but the emotion is dragging us to that interaction. That's what it's like for spirits. When people lose their physical body, their life is dominated by much more strongly by their emotions.
In one of the chapters of book group that you've just recently done, there was a description of that. Well worth watching. Mary's discussion about it.
Read it, the book. Thank you.
And over here we are.
I now have 2 questions, if that's okay. About the earthbound spirits, when they have a very strong guilt feeling that they've left and they're not looking after the people they left behind, or if the person who's left behind is feeling a lot of emotions towards the other spirit, is that holding them back as well?
Yes. Most of the time, it is our emotions of the people who are still alive on Earth, it is our emotions that draw these 22 billion people back to the Earth. If we did not have the emotions we have, these people would never have their addictions being met, and therefore they would never feel drawn to coming back here. And if they did want to come back through their own desire, they wouldn't be drawn by somebody else, but if through their own desire, there would be nobody that they could influence. That's the reality. We have the prospect in the future of having no spirits influencing the planet if we understand the truth about the matter.
The other question is going back to pleasures and allurements.
Mm-hmm.
I was reading the prayer the other day and the word pleasures just kept on jumping out at me. And I understand that the pleasures is the negative pleasures, the ones that aren't loving.
Well, they are the pleasures that are driven by the addictions.
By the addictions, not necessarily the ones that are really good ones and happy ones and, you know.
Yeah, well, yeah. God's created our body to experience all sorts of pleasure. We're not talking about that in a manner that's being expressed lovingly, but rather we're talking about it when we express those desires for those pleasures unlovingly. These are the ones that we refer to in the Paget message prayer.
And it's just understanding the difference. So if you're being influenced by a spirit at the time and you think, yeah, this is a really loving one, mm-hmm. and then you realise, oops, no, it's not.
Yep. I've seen many people who are terrified, for example, purposefully go to take photos of a riot. Right. Now, can you see that if you're taking photos of a riot, that at some point you might finish up getting involved with the riot on a receiving end of the riot? But I've seen people who are terrified of a riot be so attracted to it because of the denial of their terror that they finish up taking photos of one. It's very interesting, isn't it? What emotions can drive us to do some of the things we do. Placing ourselves in dangerous positions driven by some kind of a temptation or allurement. And if it's just to even know what's going on causes a temptation that causes us to be in a location that can sometimes be dangerous to our own health. Yeah, Natalie?
Adrian, I'm just curious of the 22 billion earthbound spirits. I've heard you speak with spirits that are not aware of a spirit world, and I'm just wondering if you have an idea of a percentage, perhaps, of how many of those earthbound spirits are not even aware that there is a spirit world.
Around one third of the spirits that are earthbound have no idea that there is a spirit world, and around one third of them also have no idea that they have died.
The same third?
Mm, often. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
And many of them have no idea. When I say no idea, they were taught there was a spirit world on Earth, but it never entered their heart, you know, it never entered their consciousness as a feeling, and so they just don't believe it. And so when they pass, they still are staying on Earth, and many of them are still thinking that they have a physical body as well. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Just behind you, straight behind. And then straight in front.
Thanks. I don't understand if they...
Just hold the mic a bit closer.
Yeah. If they die and all their friends die, don't they get it?
Well, the problem is many of them don't get it until all of their friends die. So you look at a person who dies in their, you know, 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, how long do they have to wait till all their friends die? Usually it's 30, 40, sometimes 50 years, yes? Where they wait till all their friends die. Oftentimes, people are earthbound for 50 years as a result of that. Right? But then they get so caught up in some addictions with people on the earth, like might be an addiction to drinking or alcohol or some kind of other emotional addiction, that they then transfer the addiction to the person that they had the addiction with dies. And so what they do is they look for another person they can have the addiction with without even thinking of moving on themselves or what happened to the person who just died. Yeah. Things are not as obvious as what many of you believe, which you will actually find out when you arrive in the spirit world. Yeah. We come down in front to Rani, and then somebody else here. Yes, over there.
Thanks, Ajay. Going back to the book group, when I was reading it, wondering about, you know how you said Marie was like kind of drawn here, there and everywhere. So I always wondered why, you know, the group of women spirits who try and control and so forth, is it because of their main feeling is control, that that's what they're driven to do?
Many of the group of women spirits that you're referring to are women who on earth had very little power. Unfortunately, in the past, as many of you ladies know, in the past, women have been treated quite terribly, and as a result, the men had the power and the women had very little power. Now, when these women pass into the spirit world, because of their addiction to have power without feeling the emotion of grief about not having power, they desire to influence women on earth to give them more power. Does that make sense? And as a result of that, they are trying to connect to other people on earth because of their own unwillingness to feel the lack of power in their life when they are on earth. They connect to women on earth who they believe will have more power if they help them. And as a result, they influence many people, many women. In fact, in Brazil, when we were in Brazil, most of the women that we met in Brazil were heavily influenced by women who felt powerless in the spirit world and who are now earthbound, trying to create a matriarchal society in Brazil. Yeah. And they're well on the road to succeeding, by the way. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is literally a matriarchal society. Yep. Peter, next. Oh, sorry, we're here first and then Dan.
Can spirits in the spirit world connect to another spirit in the spirit world through addictions, and can there be a chain reaction, like a higher spirit who's been there long enough connect to an earthbound with an addiction that they can connect to, so that they can connect to the earth? Or is it just...
I understand the question. It's actually the opposite way that you think. The darker spirits often control lighter spirits who are in fear. So very dark spirits who are enraged often control brighter spirits who are in fear, still in the first sphere, so still in the hells of the first sphere, if they would go there. And these spirits that are in fear are totally dictated, their entire life is dictated by these darker, rageful spirits. And it's the threat of death and other things that they still feel from them. They feel the threat of violence from these darker spirits. And so the darker spirits often manipulate the lighter spirits into manipulating people on earth. Does that make sense? Yep. So if we come down to Peter and then across to here, we've got to be careful we don't get too snowed under with all these questions, because there's a lot more we need to say.
When one of us here in this room passes into the spirit world, should the first thing that we do when we arrive be to continue with our focus on our relationship with God and to ask for help?
Of course, but it has to be sincere, Peter. And this is where even many in this room are yet to have a sincere desire for God. See, remember, a prayer is actually a sincere, heartfelt emotion towards God. So unless I have a sincere, heartfelt desire to have a relationship with God, then I won't have one. Also, unless I have a sincere, heartfelt desire to get help, I won't get any help. It has to be driven by sincerity. Everything in the spirit world is driven by sincerity. Even the darkest of deeds is driven by sincerity. It's what they really want to do.
So besides the desire for truth, what's the spark that needs to ignite to cause that sincerity to occur?
I don't know, Pete. If I knew that answer to that question, I would be convincing a lot more people about the divine truth.
I've never heard you say that you didn't know an answer to a question before.
No, I've also said I don't know who made God. Okay. So those two questions I've got no idea the answer about. My feelings are that sincerity, unfortunately, with the way that things happen to us now, we sort of get beaten into submission before we develop sincerity. That doesn't need to be the case. And I often wonder with Mary in our private discussions why people have to get to that point before they start becoming sincere. And to be frank, I don't really know why people have to have so much hardship in their life before they become sincere. Because I do not believe that is necessary to our sincerity.
Thank you. Is it easier to develop a relationship with God after you've passed?
No. It's very difficult. Because if we are addicted to the pleasures and allurements of the world, imagine, just allow yourself to remember this one thing when it comes to our spirit friends, because you've got to have some compassion for them, right? Many of you are yet to have any compassion for them because you've not been in their position. When you arrive in the spirit world, you'll be in their position, and then you'll start to have some compassion for them perhaps. But what we want to do is have compassion for them before then. Now let's look at what their situation is. Many times on the earth, they've had a difficult life just like you have. They've had difficult situations and circumstances just like you have. They've had a difficult upbringing just like many of us have. They've had many choices in their life that they've made that have been out of harmony with love, and their soul has become darker as a result of those choices. This is all feelings that they now have within them. They are feelings that are real, that are sitting there inside of their soul, that drive their actions. Now, here on earth, many of you, the only reason why you don't take a particular action is because there's a law against it. Or you're afraid of public opinion about taking that particular action. In the spirit world, you will be attracted to a location where everybody has the same opinion as you. So if your opinion is, I'm allowed to be angry with men because all men are bastards, you're going to be attracted to a group of women who all believe they're allowed to be angry with men because all men are bastards. They are going to have exactly the same feeling as you. Now, can you imagine trying to get out of that feeling while you've got 1,000 other women surrounding you who all have the same feeling? Can you imagine how difficult that would be? Very difficult. So there they are. I've now attracted a group of people that have exactly the same opinions, belief systems, and often the same history and life that I have had. How difficult is it going to be for me to get out of that position in comparison to getting out of position on earth? In addition, I now have unfettered restrictions. In other words, I can come and go on the earth as I please. See, on earth, when we're here, we have limitations, do we not? We have limitations of cost. We have limitations of time. We have limitations in terms that we have to earn a living, as we say. You know, we have to eat and we have to sleep. And there's certain things we have to do. Imagine you have none of those limitations for a moment. None. You didn't have to work. So all of that 40 hours a week that you spent working while you're on earth, you no longer have to spend working. Imagine that. How much free time does that give you to do exactly what you want? Right? Now, if exactly what you want is to get some addictions met, it gives you 40 hours more free time to get those addictions met. On top of that, you now don't have to pay money, fuel or a car or anything like that to get from A to B. You can just think your way from A to B. So I'm over here and I'm spending my time with Peter, and all of a sudden I think, oh, that's right, Peter's got a cousin down in Melbourne. He's probably got the same addiction as Peter. Oh, bang, I'm there. And sure enough, he's got the same, there's two people now that I can get my stuff met through. Now, can you see, with all of those allurements and no restrictions, the majority of people would just go and do exactly what they want. And majority of people who pass do exactly that. There is no law in the spirit world preventing you from doing exactly what you want, even if what you want is very harsh and harmful.
So let's just say that we all passed right now. What would be your best advice for us?
You've asked these kind of questions before, Peter. But my best advice would be to understand that you have your best opportunity of developing sincerity while you're here. You have your best opportunity of understanding truth while you're here. You have your best opportunity of understanding and developing a relationship with God while you're here. It is far more difficult than you can imagine currently to develop these things when you arrive in the spirit world if you have no foundation in them at all. So my suggestion is, before you pass, not after, before you pass, develop these things here. Right? That's the whole reason why myself and Mary came here, because there is so much trouble for people who try to develop these things after they've left here. But if you are in the unfortunate circumstance where you have not developed these things here and you pass into the spirit world, you are going to be faced with a much more difficult time to develop those particular things.
How is it then that the people who write messages in the Paget messages and how they end up in a... They start off in a fairly dark place, but in a relatively short space of time, with the help of the band of group who are there, mm-hmm. they make amazing progress and seem to go to a much better place quite fast.
I think you already know the answer to that, don't you, Pete? Like, they are connecting with their friends, people they know, who they trust, who have demonstrated to them through their own personal appearance the condition they're really in. And because of that influence, they progress positively.
Oh, you know, I think it's more than that, Pete. I think it's exactly what you were just talking about before. At the time where they've really asked a question, they've developed a quality of sincerity. And it's the same for us here. When we're really sincere about growing, about our relationship with God, changes happen really rapidly. Some people stay in the spirit world for years and decades and centuries, some of them, before they develop sincerity. And when they develop it, they come to people, ask a sincere question, they get a sincere answer, and they're off.
And but, Pete, I think you're also selectively reading the Paget messages, to
yes.
be frank, because there are many experiences in the Paget messages where people have, where higher spirits have gone to a person who's in a lower condition and said, oh, they just don't want to hear, they don't want to listen, they don't want to understand. And remember, there was one experience of a man who said, it's very hard to learn of heavenly things while you're in hell. Yeah. Right? And so we need to understand the messages as a whole system, not just a few of the messages. But that's enough questions for you now. Let's move on to some more.
Going back to your to the comment that you made about the spirits in the spirit world who are rageful and then they attach to other brighter spirits in the spirit world who are fearful, mm-hmm. that's very similar for us here too then, isn't it? It's
exactly.
through our fear that they attach.
Exactly.
So if we allow ourselves to feel the fear of whatever the interaction with the spirit is, will that will ease us through to the truth of it?
Certainly, but for many of us, we are not feeling the fear, we are acting in fear, which is a very different thing.
So can you sort of clarify that a little bit, give us a bit of an idea of what the difference might look like?
We will as we proceed in this discussion.
Yeah.
Many of you are asking questions which you will have answered as a natural
course. I'm going to call the roundup here.
Mary's going to round us up.
That's my job today, to keep things on track. So, so really the...
So remember we said, getting back to the point that we raised, was that the Paget message prayer demonstrates that all of us have addictions that are present that will cause us to be tempted into actions that are out of harmony with love, right? And the prayer itself, as Mary read out, demonstrates we need to start demonstrating a desire to no longer respond to these temptations. And what we need to discuss is, how do we do that? Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. So, in order to sort of direct our discussion today, we've chosen a Bible verse, which is a little unusual and has really strong language in it, but we both feel there's some very beautiful truths and lessons within the passage. So I'm going to read it to you.
Can I give a bit of background first about the Bible verse?
Yes.
This Bible verse was written by the man who is now called the Apostle Paul. And Paul, I first had an interaction with Paul from the spirit world. He never met me on earth, and I appeared to him as a spirit and tried to influence him against his attacks on other Christians who were on earth at the time. And Paul responded to that influence to such an extent that he became quite a passionate, what he believed was a follower of my teachings. Of course, it was the teachings that he could discover at the time, which was a few years after my death. He, as a result of that, was often inspired, and we often, myself and Paul, often had a connection, me in the spirit world, him on earth, where I could channel things to him because of his passions. And he was quite a good channel, actually. One of the reasons why he was attacking the Christians is he was channeling a group of Jewish spirits before then who were enraged by the whole Christian movement in the first century. And he responded to those spirits and he did what they wanted him to do until such a time as he had this interaction with myself. So we could channel information to him. And so oftentimes we channeled correct information to him, some of which has been manipulated since through later Bible revisionists. But this is one verse that is very much, very close to what was originally given to him. So,
okay. So it's a verse from Ephesians chapter 6. And I've actually brought with me today a few different versions from a few different Bibles because the language varies slightly. But the first, I'll read it all through first, and then we'll go through line by line and discover the meaning in it. And this version of the verse is from the New International Version. So it's Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 to 18. It says, "Put on the full armour of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one." Babe, are you distracting from the verse?
Sorry, yeah.
I don't know if anyone's heard it. "Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people."
Okay.
Sounds fairly full on, doesn't it?
So this Bible verse describes almost exactly how you can combat and actually positively respond to any influence.
So let's see how that's true.
How that's true.
Okay. So the first part of the verse says, "Put on the full armor of God, so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." So firstly, can you clarify this reference to the devil?
Yeah, well, that was added as a later revisionist added it. What we actually talked about when we channeled the information to Paul, we actually talked about any person who is wicked. So we actually talk about, we, in place of that, we actually said the wicked one's schemes. In a sense?
Okay.
By the way, for those of you who have not heard this before, there is no devil.
Yes, can we clarify?
Mind you, there are some spirits in the spirit world who are a lot worse than what you can imagine the devil to be. So.
Yeah. So the next part says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms."
So if you examine, you know, the fact that here we are on the earth, people, mankind are on the earth, there are literally groups of spirits who guide what happens on the earth and who have guided what happens on the earth for many, many millennia, many thousands of years. These spirits are spirits who, in fact, control most of the systems of the earth. Almost every system that you can imagine on earth currently has some kind of control coming from the spirit world. And often the more organized it is and the more violent it is, the more control is coming from the spirit world. So there are very large groups of spirits who are in the spirit world who actually control the events of what happens on earth. They are the people who control through suggestion the people on earth who are either in power or in responsibility, and that causes these people who are on earth to do particular things. So the reality is the majority of us, when it comes to some kind of wickedness occurring on the earth, the majority of us are not actually fighting against the person who's being wicked on earth. The reality is those people have a very large amount of influence from the spirit world. So here, let's say this person is a person who is acting in an evil manner, meaning out of harmony with love and violently attacking. These spirits will be influencing that person into doing that, right? And even that person, to a degree, doesn't understand how much they're being influenced, because these people who are unseen, as the scripture says, the people in the spirit world who are unseen are the people who have a lot of influence on what is going on. And because they're unseen, this person often doesn't know they're being influenced so much. Many of you have heard of people who have gone on a murder spree, for example, and you read about them and you often see them, they have a blank look in their eye and they just say, "I can't remember what actually happened. You know, something seemed to overtake me, voices told me to do this." All sorts of things they say, which none of us believe on earth generally, but these are actually the influences of spirits occurring to do these influence, have this influence over people. So, if we're a person who's wanting to develop a relationship with God, then the persons who are wanting to stop our relationship with God are not so much the people on earth, but rather the spirits who are with the people on earth that are attempting to stop our relationship. Does that make sense? Yeah? Is there any questions about that, Jenna? Down the front here, thanks.
You were talking earlier about how spirits influence other spirits. Are there any dark spirits that are unseen by other spirits? Like, can they influence other spirits without that second spirit knowing it? You know what I'm saying?
It's very unusual for them to not see, because the darker spirits, who are the persons who are in rage and influencing the more brighter spirits, the brighter spirits can choose to see them. But it is a choice. Do you choose to see the things you are afraid of? See, most of us choose to ignore the things we're afraid of, do we not? So this is what happens to many of these spirits. These spirits who are a little bit brighter, who are in fear, choose to ignore the sight of a spirit who is in rage. Just the same way that you, in your day-to-day life, often choose to ignore anything you're afraid of. Does that make sense to you? Yep. Yep. So while they have the capacity to see the darker spirit, they often choose to not see it. Just like many of you will probably do when you pass.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
Yep. Okay.
So is that clear for everyone that in the New World Translation, they talk about against the authorities, against the rulers of this darkness, against wicked spirit forces in the heavenly places. So that's this darkness is talking about the darkness that dominates the earth plane, yeah?
It's not just that. It's here's our earth, and at the moment, as I've explained to you previously, our earth resides in a spiritual condition that is the same as the condition of the hells, or in many of the hells. It is in a first sphere condition in the spirit world. For that reason, any person in the first dimension of the spirit world can access the earth. If the earth was in a, if everybody on the earth was in a second sphere condition, then none of the people in the hells would even be able to come to the earth. Because it, just by their coming, they would feel so uncomfortable they'd have to leave again. Right? The reason why they feel drawn back to the earth is because the earth is very attractive to them because it's of a very similar condition. And this is the reason why they're drawn back. So the rulers of this, the people who are the rulers, are these people who are in the darkest conditions of the hills. And they rule, that's not very good, they rule through terror. I'll draw them. And they rule through terror. They have a reign of terror in the depths of hell. Do you understand? Just like if you think of like how the Jews would have felt in Nazi Germany, or how it would have been to be, you know, something from a different country in Russia during the Stalin years, someone who was opposed to the government in the Stalin years. That's the kind of terror that these particular people rule by. The same kind of terror that often gets demonstrated on Earth. They have a rule of terror upon all the people who are afraid of them. Your fear is a very, very damaging emotion to this world because it allows you to be ruled by others who are willing to manipulate your fear. That's why it's such a damaging emotion. See, a lot of people would say that terror is the, you know, the rage is the damaging emotion. Well, while rage is damaging, nobody, not a single one of us, would be able to be ruled by a person enraged unless we have terror, unless we have fear. Every single one of us would stand up firm to a person who's enraged if we did not have fear. So fear actually enables a person enraged. Every time you act upon your fear, you are enabling the people who are the rulers of this darkness, and these people are in the spirit world, you are enabling them every time you act in your fear. Does that make sense to everyone? Very important to understand that, right? Because if we understand that, we start to see the relationship between our terror or our fear and what it allows to be created around us. Now, they are in the first dimension of the spirit world, as the scripture mentions, and they are in the hells of the spirit world, and they have their reign of terror. And as a result of their reign of terror, they are able to rule over the earth by influencing people through terror, through rage. That's how they have control of this planet.
Bob, you had a question?
In a channeling that I had once, a few months back or 6 months or so back, I was actually shown the universe looking down upon it once we had got out of the hells, the first sphere into the second sphere, and the layer of love that God has put around the universe, that all of these spirits were all floating around and they couldn't penetrate through it. So around the universe was this darkness of spirits, but they couldn't penetrate this layer of love that now was around the universe because we had we had increased our level of love on the earth, and it was a very beautiful sight.
Yes, remember that I mentioned that every new dimensional sphere is a boundary of love, right? And these spirits, although they have rule over the world and many people in the world, and more so rule over many people in the first dimension of the spirit world, they are not able to affect anything above there. They can't affect anyone in the second dimension or third or fourth or fifth. There are literally huge areas of the spirit world that are perfectly free from any of this negative influence.
It really showed me that God's laws, God's decisions and laws are just are beautiful, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, because definitely. Once we'd come to that realization, we dealt with our fear, because it was our fear that was holding us there. And this was what it was all about for me. It was my fear that was holding me where I was.
Yes.
Once that was let go and we could deal with it, that it just changed. And everybody did that. It just changed everything.
Yes.
Just that one thing changed everything so dramatically for us here
That's
on Earth.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. If we all dealt with the emotion of fear, we would not have this situation. That is very true. Many of us, of course, are terrified of dealing with the emotion of fear. We are afraid of being afraid. So we avoid addressing the emotion. Okay.
Okay. Therefore, put on the full armour of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand.
Now, for many of you, the day of evil is happening every day at the moment. So, that's the way it is, unfortunately. So, remember, when we're speaking about some things like the day of evil, for example, mentioned in the Bible, later Bible revisionists turned that into be like the time of Armageddon or some kind of cataclysm or something like that. This is why a lot of the media, when they attack me, one of the first things they say to me is, "You're preaching a, cataclysmic thing like all cults." And I say, "No, I'm not. I don't have any fear of the future whatsoever. And I'm not preaching that there is some kind of cataclysmic event in the future that's going to harm most of society. I do believe there are going to be some changes on the planet, but that's very, very different to feeling that it's cataclysmic or damaging. And I certainly have none of those feelings."
And actually the English Standard Version says that you may be able to stand in the evil day, not...
Yes, in the evil day, which can be at any day that you are tempted to do something that to destroy your own relationship with God, basically.
So then could you give us an overview? What is meant by this armour of God that we're hearing about?
Well, what we did in illustration here, and Paul loved illustrations, as many of you probably know if you come from a Christian background. So what we tried to do is put together an illustration of something that was pretty common in the day, which was a Roman soldier with a suit of armour ready to conquer, whatever he viewed as the enemy. And if the average soldier had a certain amount of gear that he had on him, and if you talk to Connie, you'll find that sometimes that gear was pretty heavy, can often, with the way that it was made, often weigh up to an additional 50 more pounds than you weighed. And so it was like carrying around this like suit to prevent you from getting injured or harmed. Of course, that's the primary reason why the suit was available. So what Paul was recommending is that we have a suit of armour that comes from God. Right? So this is all about your relationship with God. There are certain things that each one of these particular pieces that are described in the armour that come from God that will help you in your battle to positively respond to any spirit influence that comes along. Or as they say in the verse, in your battle against the evil forces in the dark places. Now, personally, my opinion is they are just human beings. So, that helps a lot with understanding their underlying motivations and how they feel. But they are still going to attempt to influence you because they want their addictions met. Now, some of them want the addiction of power. Some of them want the addiction of sexual addictions. Some of them want the addiction of control. Some of them, you know, all sorts of addictions exist, just like they do here on the earth. And these addictions are what we are fighting against when it comes to dealing with it. So don't feel that you're fighting against the spirit themselves, because you're not. You're fighting against the underlying emotions that these spirits are projecting at you and causing you to change or be influenced in your life. So this is what the suit is.
All right, I'm borrowing the next verse from the New World Translation. Stand firm, therefore, with your loins girded about with truth.
So here we go, truth.
And having on the breastplate of righteousness.
That's righteousness. Yeah.
So what does that mean?
Can we just read the verse again and I'll write down what each thing was? This one's the shield of,
yes.
Can you remember? Faith, yeah. This was the helmet of, can you remember? Salvation.
Salvation.
And the feet were shod with the good news of?
Peace, the gospel of peace.
Okay, and the sword was the?
Spirit.
Sword of the Spirit. Right. Okay. So here we have a blueprint for how to combat any spirit influence that we may ever come against in our life. Right? It's just a matter of understanding it, like any blueprint. Okay. So the very first one Mary mentioned was this one, the loins. The loins girded with?
Truth.
Truth. What does that mean to you, do you think? Any ideas? Loins girded with truth. Why this area? And why? What relationship has that got to do with truth, do you think?
Deb?
Okay, so let's go Deb and then...
Everyone's got that thing that... Oh.
If you leave your hand up, it's okay. If you're certain to give an answer, leave your hand up. And yes.
Is it because the emotions are kind of primarily located around the gut, around the loins?
Well, it's actually the bottom two chakra areas that we're talking about here. Now, what do we know from our metaphysical studies that many of you have done? What are the bottom two chakra areas about? Can you remember? The base chakra, was that a lot about?
Jen,
if we come, sorry, we need a mic down here. Sorry.
Yeah.
We'll come back to you in a minute. So Jen, base chakra, what's that one about?
It's our foundational belief systems as well as tribe,
systems?
Like beliefs of the tribe, the family.
It's family belief systems.
So family-related belief systems, yes. And basically our entire family, which includes our environment, of course, right?
So
what else? What else is that base chakra? What is that your base chakra, people?
Six.
So, okay, there's some sexual issues here, isn't there, that we didn't want to say that. When are you going to get used to talking about sex? Sometime in the distant future.
Did you hear what Yvonne said?
What did you just say, Yvonne?
When I have some.
When I have some. Up until then, it's like not talking about it at all. Exactly. Okay, so belief, sexuality. Anything else from your metaphysical, Karen? Just...
I just thought when fear, to confront your fear, you need to hold on to some truth. But
fear is this area here generally. That's where we store it in our body. But so Alex, right up back there. Thanks, Connie. Giving Connie a bit of a jog now.
I think there's some self-acceptance stuff in the lowest. Yeah.
Okay, well, now we're starting to talk about something into in the second chakra. So self-acceptance with regard to sexuality in the first, and general self-acceptance and self-worth in the second, yes? Is that not true? That's where we see all of those kind of things, yeah? If we come across here, just...
I understand the base chakra is described as I am. It's who I
who
feel
I
am.
Am. Yeah, who I feel I am.
And any of you look at the development of the fetus, we start basically at the coccyx.
Yep.
And that spinal. So it's the basic development, the basic life, the primordial.
True. True.
Yeah.
Yep. That's good. Just behind.
I know it as primarily survival.
Yes. Very much about survival. Mm. Okay. Okay. So can we... can we now make some suppositions about what this loins girded with truth is about, do you think? If we come to Barbara down here.
Just your grounding, you're standing firm, you're grounding your roots.
Yeah, whose truth is it?
Well, at this stage, it's our truth.
Well, yes, but it really should be God's truth.
It should
truth,
be God's
it?
Truth, but yeah, it's not
so,
at the moment.
So we're talking about God's truth here.
Okay, right here.
We want our basic person to be totally grounded in what is the truth from
stand
God's
firm in the
perspective.
Truth.
Yeah. We want to protect the truth at all costs, not by our words, but by how we act in our day-to-day life. So once we've established a truth in our day-to-day life, we want to make sure that we never let that truth go. Once we've established it. We're not saying if we have no idea, then we can't do that. Once we have an idea of what the truth is, now we want it to be established as the truth. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Okay.
So would you add to that also the idea of my worth as God's child, my sexuality?
So what's the basic truth about your worth as God's child?
The greatest of his creation.
You are the greatest of his creation. How many times do you believe that? Not very often for many of us, right? But the reality is we need to stay firm in that grounding of what we know, even if it's an intellectual knowledge, that we are the greatest of God's creation. We are a person worth loving. We are a person who is able and is currently loved by God. There's a lot of other truth in amongst that. God is a loving individual. God is not a punishing individual. God doesn't try to make your life hard on purpose. Right? God always loves you in every interaction. All of God's laws are loving. These are all truths. Right? These are all truths that we need to keep as a protection of our basic self, that we need to understand about ourself. You see, while we have these truths protecting our core self, we won't be misled into thinking that somehow we're a person that deserves to be punished for the rest of our life, for example.
And I know for myself, it's my willingness to drop those truths that has always led to me to spirit influence. The feeling that it's okay to punish myself, or the feeling that I'm not really worth anything, the desire to avoid that feeling and get other feelings from other people have all been ways where I've discarded God's truth, sat in my stuff, and then wanted spirits to help me out of it.
Now, if I was fully grounded in the basic truth that I am a person who God loves deeply, and I was fully grounded in the other truth that God is a God of love, can you see how much that would protect you from negative spirit influence? How many times do we do something that is completely out of harmony with those two basic truths? In other words, completely out of harmony with the basic truth that God loves you. How many beliefs do you currently even have where you believe that you're not loved? That God doesn't love you that much, that God doesn't care about you that much. And how easy is it to manipulate a person who believes that they deserve to be punished? It's pretty easy to manipulate a person who feels like they deserve to be punished, isn't it? Like, you see a little child, and oftentimes the parent's saying, I'm smacking you because I love you. So they're saying that violence is a fact of love. And here in this basic truth that we've just stated, violence is not a fact of love. Right? Imagine how much that would protect the child in that environment. They'd be going, Mummy, you can say you love me, but you do not, because you're belting me at the moment. Right? And they'd be able to say that definitely if they felt that inside of themselves, wouldn't they? They would not be influenced by such a person. Just if they knew that one truth. Even a child would not be as influenced if they knew that truth inside of themselves. Imagine you now as an adult, and you know for certain that God is only loving and that you can and should be loved by God. And you are, in fact, loved by God, and you knew that for certain. Doesn't matter how much somebody told you how useless you are, how bad you are, or how disappointing you are, you know, you would not believe them, would you? Every single day I get a few emails generally every single day telling me how bad I am, right? Telling me how useless I am, how, you know, and it ranges from all sorts of things, doesn't it, babe? Like, from, you know...
From your addiction to your overall underlying evil intentions.
Yeah, everything in between.
Yeah.
And the reality is my own feelings that I am loved by God prevent me from absorbing those attacks. Just that one feeling. Now, if a person has a true complaint with me, as many of you now know, you can come and talk to me about it and we can discuss it. But if you are willing to treat me badly in that interaction, you also know that I will not do that with you. Right? Why? Because I understand inside of myself more and more, I still don't understand it perfectly, but I understand it more and more, that each of us deserves to be loved and that we are actually loved. And no matter how bad you think I am, God still loves me. That's a pretty safe place, isn't it? When you can feel that. No matter how bad somebody else thinks you are, that God still loves you. Right. One of the biggest complaints against the normal Christian face on the planet is the judgment that comes from the face towards people who do what the faith calls evil things. The judgments towards the prostitutes, the drunkards, the drug addicts, the, you know, any person who they classify as evil, which I am classified as evil by the same people, and say they tell me all the things that I'm evil about as well. I'm much worse than a prostitute, of course, in their eyes, because I am the apostate of all apostates. Right? Now, all of those emotions getting projected at you, you imagine how easy it is for a spirit to hook into that and cause you to feel really bad about yourself with all of that emotion coming at you. But if your loins, your basic sense of yourself, is firmly grounded in this understanding that God loves you and that you are a lovable person, that you can be loved, and you are firmly grounded in who you know yourself to be, you will not get upset with a person attacking you, and you also will not feel as attacked as much, will you? You go, okay, they're allowed to have their own opinion, but it will not change your actions and what you choose to do with your life. Can you see that? Yep. Alex, you have a question?
Hey, Jay, I'm just wondering how I'm going to put this into practice, because I can already see myself, like, intellectually, if I'm getting attacked, intellectually telling myself, okay, no, God loves me, I'm a good person. So how... Sounds good what you're saying. How do I put that into practice?
Well, there's two very simple things that you need to do. One is to tell yourself the truth. Right? The truth is God does love you. Right? And the truth is this person who's attacking you does not. Right? They're harming you. The second thing you need to let yourself do is feel the attack. Because if you feel the attack, you will actually not change what you do, but you'll just allow yourself to feel it and you'll release an emotion. And in the process of releasing an emotion, you'll come to feel this truth. But you first have to at least tell yourself the truth, otherwise you'll never get to the second part. You'll just go, oh yeah, you're right. I am terrible. I'm worthless. I am unworthy to be loved. God doesn't love me. I might as well commit suicide. And then what do you have? You have 50 spirits who have all committed suicide surrounding you saying, yeah, go for it. You know, here's a knife, here's a gun, here's a this, here's a that. You know, they'll give you all the means to do it. You know, that's the way they work. But if you tell yourself the truth, God loves me, what you're telling me is false, I know that because I just have that intellectual knowledge at least, then all you need to do is just allow yourself to feel the attack. In other words, have some grief about being attacked by a person who doesn't love you. That's all you need to do.
Yeah, I know a lot of time, I think, Alex, what you were saying is like, what if I just tell myself the truth and I use that to deny the emotion? And I know lots of us who've had like positive affirmations in our background or whatever have used a lot of words intellectually to suppress emotion.
Yeah.
But something that I've really learnt from you, from AJ, is that he does remind me of truth all the time, and it does actually help me feel more. When I'm willing to let go of the truth of the situation and go, yeah, I am a bad person, it just sends me into this downward spiral where a heap of spirits jump on and suddenly I feel dreadful. It's a lesson that I'm learning to remind myself of truth, even if it's intellectually, but stay focused on humility. It's when we use the intellect to try and avoid humility that nothing works. But in my experience, the only way I've ever grown emotionally is to grieve the real situation that's happening. So is to grieve not that I'm a bad person, but gee, it hurts that other people are calling me a bad person.
Mm. Can you see the difference, Alex? Like one is a fiction. The statement, I am a bad person, is a fiction. The statement, they're treating me as if I'm a bad person, is not a fiction. That might be a fact. We can only grieve facts. We can't grieve fictions.
We can only release, yeah.
Yeah, I started actually processing like anger towards my parents that I'm in at the moment and saying, God loves me and you didn't.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, I feel there's a change around that.
Yep, no, that's good.
So, I just want some confirmation.
Yeah, often what I find is a person who's being attacked goes into the belief of accepting the person that's attacking them and the belief systems of the person that's attacking them. So in our interaction with myself and Mary, sometimes she'll get a phone call from somebody who attacks her or an email from somebody who attacks her. And I just say, babe, you're a beautiful person. And sure, you might have some things to work on, but this person is attacking you. You know, that makes them not a very nice person. As soon as they attack you, they're not a very nice person. You don't go around attacking everybody. So you're a more beautiful person than that. And often just me saying that, Mary Ellen has a big cry. Because she feels the recognition of the fact that she doesn't deserve the attack. You see, what the spirits want to convince you is that you do deserve the attack. That's what they want to convince you. They want to convince you that, just like your parents wanted to convince you in many cases, that you deserve to get the violent belting because you did something that they disagreed with. Right? That's what the parents want to convince you many of the times, and that's also what these spirits want to maintain. While they maintain that with you, they have control of you. All they've got to do is make you feel bad about yourself, and you're theirs. Basically, you're theirs. You see, while you have your loins girded with these beliefs about yourself, that you have an intention to do good, that you have an intention to love, and you have an intention to be loving towards other people. These underscoring belief systems are protecting you, and you have a desire to understand that God loves you, even though you might not feel that yet. That is going to protect you from all of this dark attack causing you to get into this self-degrading, and depressive state, where eventually we just want to top ourselves, or suicide probably if you're not an Australian, you know, just in order to get away from how bad we feel about ourselves. And often it all began with our unwillingness to just stay firm to the truth that we've already been shown. Yeah. Does that make sense to everyone? Can you see the importance of just that one thing? Now, how many of you have gone into these spirals? Have you done that? Yeah? Many of you? Yeah. These spirals are often induced by spirits around you. They want to make you feel bad about yourself. You know, you look at every single... I've just updated our website and put a list of my responses to media attacks that have happened in the past on the website. If you look under media responses, you'll see it there on the website. And with the help of Luli, who's been great at getting all the details together so that we can respond, we've put together some responses. Now, if I actually believed everything about myself that the media said about me, I would be an absolute mess. Like, I'd feel pretty bad about myself if everything they said was true, right? How do you hold on to beliefs about yourself that you know are not true? By grounding them in God's truth about you. Right? That's how you hold on to it. And intellectually, it may be an intellectual process initially. Eventually, you allow yourself to feel the grief of the attacks. And eventually the grief will be gone and you won't even grieve the attacks anymore. That's eventually where you will arrive. But if that truth is not grounded in you, what will you do? You'll go, oh yeah, they're right. I'm a terrible person. Look at me. Look at how bad I am. These are the exact messages that many of us grew up with all of our life. Look at how bad you are, you're all to blame, so forth. And we go into this spiral, and then the spirits just grab on top of that and chuck us into this spiral because they love to torment a person who's down. That's what they love doing. Just like many people on earth love doing, right? You notice that? Just recently, there was a Facebook thing that we heard about, because both Mayor and I are not on Facebook, of a woman who had multiple...
Which story are you telling? The Sikh woman?
Yes, the Sikh one.
Oh, that was a nice story.
Yeah.
It was a Sikh lady who, because of her faith, once she's goes through a certain process in her faith, she has to wear 5 or 7 signs of her faith, but also she can't modify her personal experience.
Or her personal appearance.
What did I say?
Experience, I think.
Sorry, appearance.
She's not allowed to change her personal
appearance. Her personal appearance.
And under the guidelines of her own faith.
Of her faith. And it's about being focused on service rather than appearance. And she had quite a lot of facial hair that she wasn't removing.
She has almost looks like a beard.
And somebody took a photo of her waiting in line somewhere. And obviously she has breasts, but she has this sort of beard. And this whole campaign on Facebook started sort of taunting her. Like,
just attacking her, making fun of her, making fun of, you know, her facial hair. And just attacking her.
But a beautiful thing resulted in that she had this feeling about herself, and she heard about it and she responded quite...
She actually put a response on the page.
Yes, saying, this is actually me and this is the reason why I look like this and this is what I believe, and actually kind of flipped the entire interaction around. The person who posted the photo ended up writing to her to apologise, and a number of people who'd been cruel to her on the page went out of their way to apologise to her. So it was also a lovely example of love overcoming evil. But she was very grounded in the fact that I am who I am, this is what I believe in, and I don't feel bad or ashamed about that. Yeah.
So it's a fantastic experience, isn't it? Mm. Like in a good illustration of somebody who would not accept the attacks of others just because others believed a certain thing. Mm. Yeah. If we come down the front and then up the back.
My understanding is that the second chakra is about our relationship with others as well. And I read that story and she was so loving in her description of the truth. And I feel that another important thing about girding our loins with truth is being steadfast in being in our actions to be loving towards others.
Mm. Yep, I agree. Yeah.
That'll come later.
Yep. If we go up to Natalie.
So AJ, just in relation to what you're talking about with the attack of spirits, so can I use the example of someone who's murdered?
Can I use your example?
Sure.
You have a history of, shall we call it, sexual promiscuity?
Yes.
You feel ashamed of that?
Yes.
The spirits with you want you to feel ashamed of that?
Yes.
Every time they attack you, you feel, because you're unwilling to feel the shame itself, you then feel that you are what they are saying to you.
Yes.
You feel that you are the dirty woman that they're saying you are.
Yes.
This then causes you to act in a manner that causes you to engage in further promiscuity, which is exactly what they want, because then they can share in the act and do all sorts of things with that. Does that make sense?
Yes.
This is an example of what I'm saying. See, if you understood that you are loved by God, that you are not a dirty woman, there are things that have happened in the past that have happened because of your upbringing and other issues and problems that you've faced. This doesn't define you. It only is something that happened to you. And if you understood that and you firmly understood this, you had this truth about that, every time these spirits attacked you, you wouldn't then go down into a spiral of doing what they want. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, does that answer the question you were going to ask?
Thanks.
No worries. It's interesting how we often want to use an example of something else. It's far more powerful if we relate it to ourselves. Barbara, thanks.
AJ, in the prayer where it says the influence of the evil ones, I have a real quandary about that. One is that I am coming to the understanding that everybody is my brother and sister, mm-hmm. and I need to have compassion for my brothers and sisters. And I just feel that as a real, maybe biblical term or a judgment. Is that just my upbringing? That because I go into grief when I read that every time, because I feel as if they're spirits that need my compassion and my love. And every time I read that, I get very upset by it.
Okay. So let's look at that as well, because it's an important thing you raise. The English language has a word and then it has a meaning. Almost every language is the same, by the way. It has a word and a meaning. There is no judgment associated in a dictionary. You understand? The dictionary itself is just a piece of paper with a word and a meaning. That's all it is. There's no emotion coming out of the dictionary. Right? So when we use the word evil, is that not a word in the English language? Yes, of course it is. It is a valid word in that it describes acts that damage or violently harm other people, doesn't it? That are taken, and usually when we look at the term, it's taken on purpose. It's not a mistaken act, but something that is purposefully done in order to damage or harm another person. That's our definition of evil, right? That definition is the exact definition I want to use. I don't have any judgment about the person who engages in evil, but the reality is they are engaged in an act that is evil.
So for me to get so upset by it, I must have a judgment myself.
Yes. There must be some kind of judgment coming from somewhere into your life related to that word. Many times you'll find
Christian upbringing.
Yes, very much so. Because, you know, when we were young children and we did something that we just mistakenly did, you know, like we go, mummy, I just did this. And, a lot of times you don't even know what you did, right? You don't know whether it was right or wrong. You just feel bad about it. And they go, you evil person, God says about evil persons, and off they go, right? And so what connotation do you have now about the word, which is just a word defining an act in a dictionary? See, oftentimes what happened is we were mistakenly or purposefully accused of evil when we ourselves had never engaged in it.
I had got to the stage where I was thinking maybe I considered myself evil, and therefore I...
No, you've been accused of evil when you felt it was unfair. And so now whenever you hear the word evil, you go instantly, it's unfair. Does that make sense? Instant reaction. The reality is it's just a word that's in an English language. And so just because we use a word, it doesn't mean that we have a feeling of judgment. The feeling of judgment comes from our feelings towards the person. So if I said to you that these people who engage in evil are the degradation of society and they are, you know, they deserve to be condemned to eternal torment in a hellfire, and off I went like that, right? Right? If I said all of that, now I'd be judging them. I'd be judging their evil, which is not either my right nor the truth. Right? So it's very different than the word itself. And the problem is, in our history, many of us have had these judgments perpetrated towards ourselves personally. And so then when we hear a certain word, we go instantly into some kind of reaction. Many of you did that with the word God, if you remember. Do you remember the very first interactions we had? Many of you went into a meltdown when you heard the word God coming from my lips, right? And it's another word that describes the universal creator. Right? And I could have used the word universal creator and everyone would have been happy.
Right? Well, you wanted to trigger us, didn't you?
No, I didn't want to trigger you. I just wanted to use the dictionary definition of the universal creator in the most shortest possible language, which is G-O-N-D. You know what I mean? Like, why use a long word when the short one would do? You know, the male, female, universal creator. Right? Why would I want to say that when all I need to say is God and you need to get over it? So this is the thing with words. We need to understand that words are used to correctly describe an actual a physical description of something, right? That's all their purpose is. If we feel a judgment from the word, then there's something in our history that has happened associated with that word. We were called that word, most probably, mistakenly or on purpose. We were called that word even when we didn't feel like we were bad, and we believed it many times. Yes, how many times when you were a child were you called bad or evil and you came to believe it? Right? That's the trouble. And it might not even be from a parent. It could be like school teacher, you know. You might have went to Catholic school and or you know, some religious school, and they associated evil and then wicked and devil and everything else all together, and you were evil when you did that naughty thing, and all you were doing was thinking that, you know, you were doing something very simple and basic, and now the whole world was coming down on you and God was coming down on you as well. And of course you're going to have some emotions about that. Yeah. When we use words, myself and Mary, we're using the word because that is the word. Like, you know, like for example, it's blasphemous to assume that God is a God of punishment. Now, what do we normally associate with the word blasphemous? We actually think we're going to be punished and it's going to be eternal torment, and blasphemy is the worst possible sin that you could... No, the word actually means that we are misrepresenting the truth about the individual to a negative extent, to a deeply negative extent, when we are claiming something about the person that is not true. We are committing blasphemy. That is just a word. Right? It's the same with many other words that we could use.
Another good example is we had a lot of discussion in book group about there being a penalty upon the soul. And the definition of penalty is a restriction placed upon you as a result of an action that you take. But obviously, it carries a lot of emotion for a lot of people that we would be penalised, and this feeling that it's about strict, harsh punishment. And in the end, I think I said, there is a penalty. Let's move on.
There's the word.
There's the word, and then there's the emotions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you have a response to different emotions, a different emotional response to different words, always look at what's happened in your childhood, because there's usually some kind of link between these particular things. And usually it's related to injustice of some kind that we experienced as a child. Yep. That was a little aside. We've focused on the loins girded
with truth.
With truth. Sounds very biblical, does not? Which of course it is. So do you understand the importance of that in terms of combating spirit influence? Can you see how spirits want you to shift in your perspective of truth? Now, there are certain things that you don't know, right? Like, how many of you know how the cells replicate and how fast they replicate and all those kind of things at the moment? No, not many. So you admit that there are certain things you don't know, right? Okay, so there are obviously quite a lot we don't know. You can't be firm about things you don't know. So don't try to be firm about things you don't know. Right? That's not what we're suggesting here. What we're suggesting is that the truth has to be God's truth that you have personally come to know, at least intellectually and preferably emotionally. So one of these basic truths is that God is a God of love. Now, you might not know that yet. So you might be assuming God is not a God of love, or God is a God of love at different times. So when a spirit comes along and says, God's going to punish you, you go, maybe he's right. Right? And can you see that's an automatic hole that they can now manipulate? Right? So we've got to be careful about these particular things that we don't know the truth about yet. But what I'm suggesting to you is, even if you intellectually can accept the truth that all of us are equal, therefore all of us are capable of being loved, and all of us, particularly if we have pure intentions, we don't go out and automatically try to do evil things, right? But we are trying to be people who are good, even by our own definition, we can at least have some sense of ourselves in that place. Right? And so when somebody else comes along and says, you bad, 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 bad person, we won't accept their definition of us under those circumstances. If you do, you'll notice how quickly that becomes into a very negative downward spiral influenced by spirits. Yes? Mm-hmm. It's happened to many of you already, has it not? Where you've just sort of rescued yourself after being right down there, right? And that's because of not having this firmness for one belief, just one belief about yourself, that you are worthy to be loved and God does love you. Just that one belief. All right. Can you see how important this is? It also will help protect you with regard to areas of sexuality as well. Many of us are misled by our sexual desires. Right? Many of you have entered relationships with a person you've claimed is your soulmate, only to learn a few months later that person wasn't your soulmate, and you began the relationship on that basis. Why did you do that? Because you were influenced by something sexual where you don't have integrity. Because if you had integrity, you wouldn't have done that. Does that make sense? So this is where God's truth can protect us. If we have integrity to God's truth and we have a sense of self-worth, we would never engage with another person sexually unless we were certain that we wanted to have a permanent relationship with them. Now, if each of you were certain that you wanted to have a permanent relationship with the person you were engaging with sexually, do you think a one-night stand would be possible? Well, it might be, because you might want to have them for the rest of your life. So, you know, you have to start with the first night. However, it's not going to be something where you go one person the next night, next night, next night, is it? None of those kind of things would happen because you'd have some sense of worth of yourself, right? And this is very important to understand. While you have a sense of your own worth, you will be very hard to manipulate. Spirits love manipulating you. And they manipulate through the lack of sense of your own worth. Right? This is why we're constantly, Mary and I, constantly trying to share with you. You are worthy of love. God loves you. It's just a matter of desiring this love, and this love can enter you. These are truths that are very important to understand because it will help you maintain a sense of worth for yourself. You will not put up with attack. You will not put up with other people trying to destroy you in that place because you'll have a sense of worth. Yeah? So is there any questions about that before we move on to the next one? Does everyone grasp the meaning of that? Pretty good idea, isn't it? Don't you think? It's a pretty good idea of how we can combat spirit influence. So, you know, if we just develop that one thing, imagine how much less influence we would be under. Yeah. Okay,
next one.
Let's go on, darling.
Okay, so we have the belt of truth buckled around our waist, or our loins are girded with truth, mm-hmm. and having on the breastplate of righteousness.
Okay, so that's this fellow here, this one here. The breastplate of righteousness. So it's a breastplate. I'll just write that there for the... What does the breastplate protect? Not just our heart, but actually all of our vital organs, if you think about it. You realise that if somebody put a sword in and punctured your lung, if you didn't have quick support within probably 4 to 5 minutes, you'd probably be dead, right? And obviously if they hit your heart, then obviously that's a very serious issue, right? So we're talking about a heart and other vital organs that are assigned to our instant life or death. Many of them are in this region. Other organs, if we get punctured in those, it might take a longer time to pass. But these organs here, if we're in a war, imagine, back in an old Roman time, imagine this area here, you'd want to protect that area good and proper, wouldn't you? These are vital organs. You get hit in any of those vital organs back then, high likelihood you would die within 5 minutes. Yep. Okay. So what is the breastplate of? Righteousness. It's not the breastplate of self righteousness, right? It's not that, right? So we're about the self. It's the breastplate of righteousness. Now, how does right protect the heart? What is our seat of motivation? What causes us to do things? Desire, right? So desires, we often say desires come from the heart, because they're motivated by these emotions, aren't they, of passion and longing. Yes? That's where our desires come from. If you desire something fully, you can feel it in your heart, right? So what does it mean to have a heart that is protected by righteousness?
What is righteousness?
What is righteousness? If we go out the back, yeah. Who's that?
Geraldine.
Yep. There, yeah.
It means that you're in harmony with God's laws?
Yes. Let's even be more specific. How many times do you ask yourself in the course of a day, is what I am doing now right? The right thing to do? Have you ever had that feeling? Like, what's the right thing to do here? Now, what do we mean by right? we can come down here and then across to Ange.
Just what's ethical and moral.
Right, ethical and moral, but who defines that?
From God's perspective.
But you don't talk to God yet, do you? Mm. So how do you know?
I just know for myself, if I'm about to do something that's clearly not loving or I've misread something, I just feel like something just doesn't feel right.
Perhaps what we need to do then is define wrong.
Yes.
So wrong. What do we mean when we do something wrong, Fire?
It just feels, before you're about to do it, or for me, it just feels like you just know, or for me, it's just like an internal...
Does a murderer know what's wrong?
Yeah, I think they do.
You reckon? I don't know about that.
Oh, yeah.
See, if he's brought up to believe that it's right all of his life, then how does he know what's wrong?
It's like when you died, the people thought that they were doing the right thing.
Exactly, yeah. Many of the people who were on the Sanhedrin said that they were doing the right thing. They didn't have any animosity towards me as an individual. They just felt they were doing the right thing, getting rid of a person who was an agitator. So
if you were to look back on your life and think about the wrong things I did, how would you identify them? What would be the markers on the wrong things?
Let's go to Anne. And then...
I think you're referring to the golden rule, are you?
That is part of determining what is right.
Is it loving?
Yeah.
Is it loving? Simple as is it loving?
Would I want the same thing done to me is a very good question, isn't it? I want the same thing that I'm considering doing done to me? That's a very good way of determining what is right, yes?
Is it Jennifer?
No. Sorry.
Denise.
A good feedback system is how much pain it caused to you and everybody else.
Not always a good feedback system, because a lot of people around will all say, yes, you're causing me lots of pain when you're not doing anything wrong.
Yeah.
So it's not always a good feedback system, is it?
Yep. But I admit you'd look at it.
But you can look at it, but it's not always exactly the truth.
Integrity?
Yes, having integrity is definitely involved in what is righteous. Yes, I agree. And integrity is a lot about this ethical thing, isn't it? What would I like done to me? Am I willing to do to others something that I would not like done to me? Right. So you're driving along and all of a sudden you have a bout of anger and you just want to smash the car in front of you. You obviously wouldn't like somebody to say to you, oh yeah, I smashed in the back of your car because I just had the longing to do it. Like, it wouldn't be very nice, would it? So you'd go, okay, I better not do that particular thing. It wouldn't be right for me to do that. Yeah? Okay. Right up the back, that's...
Kerry, is it?
Yeah.
When you did the wrong thing, there were consequences or punishment?
Yeah, but unfortunately we got punished when we were children for a lot of things that we didn't do that weren't wrong. Somebody else didn't like us doing it, and so we got punished. Yeah, so it's not always a good way of deciding, is it? Yep, if we go... Is
it Jason? Yeah.
Wow, we've got a lot more hair, Jason, than the last time I saw you.
From God's perspective.
Right, but so the question I'm asking is how do we determine it from God's perspective?
Your relationship with God.
Through your relationship with God, obviously, yes. And that is all about receiving some more of God's love, and then God's love will show you what is right and wrong in that process, right? But whatever, oftentimes there's two layers of questions we need to ask here. Remember the very first thing that was said about this issue is what was ethical and moral. Remember that? Now, you remember I gave a talk, I think it was in Melbourne, about ethics and morality. I don't know if you've heard that. But I define ethics and I define morality in that talk, right? My suggestion is have a look at that talk again if you can't remember it, and look at what are ethics and what are morality. We've talked a lot about ethics, and morality is a lot about God's definition of what is right. Right? And that is only through experience that we can gain that definition. So unfortunately for many of us, determining what is right must first be based on ethics. And eventually it will be based on morals. Now, let me give you some examples. Let's say I have no idea what God feels about any matter whatsoever. And I've got this opportunity to have sex with somebody's partner. Right? She's offered herself to me. Right? And she's pretty attractive. She's got a nice body and everything's looking good. And like, she's in agreement. I'm in agreement. I'm not hurting anybody. I might go down that track. But now let's ask myself the question. If I was in a relationship, how would I like for my partner to have a relationship with somebody else on that basis? I probably wouldn't like it, right? So if that's the case, ethics would demand that I don't engage sexually with this person. Can you see that? I might not have any other sense of morality. I might not know what is right or what is wrong in this particular situation. Just that one thing, that ethical principle that I wouldn't want it done to me, would prevent me from acting out of harmony with that principle. Are you with me? Yep. No? Yep. Okay. So we could say that the first point of righteousness is asking myself the basic question, would I like this to be done to myself? Now, you imagine if every single time you went to do something, you asked yourself that one question. Can you see? It'd be pretty hard for a spirit to influence you, wouldn't it? You might have 50 spirits around you all wanting you to have sex with that person, you know, because they might be able to share in the act, or they want to create havoc in your life and they want to see the slow destruction of your life through all of these different relationships, whatever it is that there is their motive. But just that one question, would I like this done to me? And honestly answered, no, I wouldn't, would stop me from acting, just that one question. Can you see? Everyone sees that, yes? Okay. Now that is different to the question of what is actually right, isn't it? Well, you know, what if that person's your soulmate and you're meant to be with them the rest of your life and you don't know this at this point in time, right? Then you might start to tell yourself, oh, it's right to have a relationship with her because I think she's my soulmate and I should go ahead with that, and it's going to cause the breakup of their marriage and that's going to be good, you know, and you come up with all this justification without asking yourself the question, would I like this done to me? Right? And this is where we go oftentimes, is we go in down into a path that is definitely not ethical. There's no ethics involved. Now, even if we just deal with the ethical question, we will be more righteous.
But we must still desire righteousness, true righteousness.
I agree. But at the beginning of any endeavour, generally, we don't know. Like, do you know for certain that it's only right to have a relationship with one person?
Yes.
How many of you feel you know that for certain? That's very few. Right? The rest of you could easily cheat on somebody without knowing that for certain. Can you see that? And that's, so there has to be something else guiding your actions that are not going to be influenced by spirits. And the ethics will do that for you. Having a sense of ethics will do that. Right? Yeah. Once this soulmate part of you opens, you'll feel the rightness of that statement. But until that point, you won't. You won't feel that. So something else has to guide your behaviour in righteousness. And that's what I'm saying, this particular statement or question, would I like this done to me, is a very good guideline for what is righteous. And it protects your heart. It protects your desires. In other words, you can recognize your desires and then see which desires are out of harmony with ethics and which desires are in harmony with ethics. Does that make sense? You can see the difference, which ones are out, which ones are in. If the desire is in harmony with ethics, then you might proceed with your desire. But if your desire is obviously out of harmony with ethics, then you'd have to question why you're proceeding down the track of following that desire, wouldn't you? So let's say your desire is to go into a rage with somebody because of what they did. If I ask myself the question, would I like a person to be enraged with me? Probably not, right? Then I would have to go, okay, my desire to be in a rage with them is out of harmony with ethics. Therefore, it is not righteous. If I engage it, in other words, I follow along with this desire to be in a rage that's out of harmony with ethics, how many spirits do you think are going to be with me doing this? There's going to be lots of spirits with me doing this. And before I know it, I'm in not only a rage, but I'm in what's called a blind rage, because I'm so overcloaked by spirits enraged by the situation that I now have no sense of reason. And that's what happens when we get out of harmony with this righteous protection of our heart. We get out of harmony with any sense of reason. So it's very important to understand that.
So there are you drawing the distinction that our desires, if they're led by righteousness, then we will be safe from spirit harm. However, if we just let ourselves be led by desire without any
measure of righteousness,
then we can end up in a very spirit-influenced state, yeah.
Yes, very much so. So we might not even know from God's perspective what is right at this point. Right? And let's face it, many of us are not yet in such a connection with God that we know what God feels on separate subjects. But most of us are in a state where we do know what we feel about a certain subject. And you know when it would hurt you if somebody did something to you. So this is a very good question to start with. Now, once you receive more and more divine love, you will have a sense of morals from God's perspective. But when you begin, that won't be the case. You will just have this ethics to guide you. This ethics will guide and protect your heart. It's like a breastplate protecting anybody from being able to manipulate your own desires against yourself. For many of us, we are being influenced by spirits of our own by our own desires that are out of harmony with ethics. So we're induced into doing something that we later regret many times because of our own desire being out of harmony with ethics, and we haven't asked ourselves the question, the basic question, would I like to have this done to me? Yeah. Once you ask yourself that question, your heart becomes very protected, right? By righteousness. And once your heart becomes that protected, it is very hard for a spirit to manipulate your desires that are out of harmony with love. Because the only way they can manipulate desires out of harmony with love is for you to be out of harmony with ethics. So this is a very powerful tool at your disposal to actually protect your heart, protect your motivations, to protect your desires, to acknowledge when your desires are out of harmony with the ethical stance that determines righteousness. A very powerful tool. Can everyone see how powerful it is? So you imagine now if you added that, you had your loins girded now, with this truth that you're very fixed and firm about your own sense of worth and about what your underlying capacity as an individual, and that God loves you, God does not desire to punish you and harm you. And you also had at the same time this breastplate that is protecting your heart from your own negative desires. It's protecting your heart from your own desire to act out of harmony with love. Right? Can you imagine now there's two great big holes that are now covered over that spirits cannot influence you with? A spirit can't come along and say, yeah, go along with that. Go and do that. And you go, that's what I want to do. Yeah, I'll do that. You know, the spirit can't influence you to do that because you ask yourself the question, I want to do that. But is that ethical? No, it's not. I can't do it. Damn it. You might feel that, right? You might feel like some sense of disappointment that you can't do it. But at least you now can acknowledge. And if you take it one step further, you can start to feel about the desire that you've now noticed is not ethical. So you can actually let yourself feel the desire, where it came from, what its source was, who taught you it, why you believe it, what addiction do you get met by following that desire. You can ask yourself all those questions now if you wanted to. Yeah. Very powerful tool. Okay, well, I think it's time to have a break, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep. So should we do that for, what is the time, by the way? 4 o'clock. Oh, sorry about that, guys. Like, sorry about that. You must be all busting. And anyway, can we have a break of 40, 45 minutes or something like that? That'd be good.